Go for it.
And how do we get Zoom to hide that part? Okay, JavaScript, the grumpy parts. Here's the part where I tell you I am definitely going to post the slides on my site tonight. You're going to check my site tomorrow, next week, next month. In about 3 months, you'll get tired of waiting for me to post my slides and you'll email me. And I'll promptly reply in 6 months and say I'll definitely post my slides. I've been that person chasing the speaker for the slides, and I never got them either, which is why you can go to robrich.org right now, and you can go grab the slides for this talk right now. Here they are, JavaScript, the grumpy parts, and here's the slide deck that we're going to look at. Feel free to get ahead, heckle me about the things I haven't said yet. While you're here on robrich.org, click on About Me, and you'll get to this page that talks about some of the things that I've done recently. I'm a Microsoft MVP. I'm a friend of Redgate. I'm a developer evangelist for a single store, a database company. AZ Give Camp is really fun. AZ Give Camp brings volunteer developers together with charities who otherwise couldn't afford software services. We start building software for them Friday after work. Sunday afternoon, we deliver completed software back to the charities. Sleep is optional, caffeine provided. If you're in Phoenix, come join us for the next AZ Give Camp. Or if you'd like a Give Camp here in Cincinnati or wherever you are, hit me up on email or Twitter, and let's get philanthropy installed in your neighborhood too. Some of the other things that I've worked on, I helped code Gulp in version 2 and version 3. That was a lot of fun. And my claim to fame, I replied to a .NET Rocks podcast episode. They read my comment on the air, and they sent me a mug. Woohoo! So there's my claim to fame, is my coveted .NET Rocks mug. So that's a little bit about me. It's so much fun that I get to be here in Cincinnati to talk about JavaScript. Now, what's really fun about JavaScript is that it is a write once, run everywhere scenario, kind of like what Java tried to be, but well, JavaScript was able to pull it off, and that's really cool. Thanks to John Mills for ideas around this talk. John Mills' talk, and I'll put the link to the slides here in chat. John Mills' talk is a guide to JavaScript scary side, and it is really cool. We go in very different directions, but if you have a chance to watch John Mills' talk, it is really cool too. So we're going to dig into the nooks and crannies of JavaScript, and that's going to be fun, but we're probably going to get to the point where we reach the edge of my knowledge. That will be really cool. I'm excited that I get to learn from you and do some really fun things here. At the same time, there's probably going to be questions where it's like, I don't know. And I look forward to those moments. Let's see if we can find some. So in the beginning, JavaScript. In the beginning, Brendan Eich wrote JavaScript in 10 days, 25 years ago. His task was to create a scripting language, kind of like Lisp, that would run in the browser. And it was, well, a really rushed project. What's interesting is I think he told the story once where maybe 40 days after he delivered it, you know, he was able to do the show. It did really cool things. Then he's like, well, there's a lot of bugs here that I would like to fix. And they said, no, we've got a dozen programs written, and there's, you know, 50 developers building JavaScript apps. We can't break them. We can't break the 50 developers. So yes, there's a lot of warts inside of JavaScript. And well, the things that I wrote 25 years ago in 10 days aren't nearly as good as JavaScript. So I can forgive Brendan Eich for all of the warts here. What's really cool is each of these blue links here are links off to additional content. As you grab the slides from robrich.org, you can click to read more about Brendan Eich building JavaScript or watch a video where he describes it. That's really cool. I invite you to go to robrich.org and grab the slides. So Brendan Eich built JavaScript in 10 days, and it got embedded in Mozilla's browser, in Netscape, and that was really cool. As JavaScript kind of took hold, all the other browsers were really good at copying both the functionality and the bugs of JavaScript. So we now have a bunch of really high fidelity clones of that engine. V8 is built into Chrome. V8 is also the engine under Node. SpiderMonkey is built into Firefox. IE has Chakra. The newer versions of Edge are actually built on Chrome and Chromium, and so they also have V8. JavaScript Core is the engine baked into Safari, and all of these engines function pretty much the same. They are JavaScript. Now, back in the day, we had lots of browser differences, and the browser differences were the way that we interact with the DOM, the document object model, the markup in the HTML page. The JavaScript engines themselves were pretty much identical. But yeah, JavaScript was weird back when browsers were weird because the DOM was weird, not so much because JavaScript was weird. JavaScript was copied with incredible precision, including the bugs. The methodology. JavaScript was built to run over there in a user's browser that arrived long after the developer had left. That user's browser is probably a memory constrained space. And so the goal of JavaScript is to keep running at all costs. And so it is a very forgiving language. That's wonderful, but that's also one of its crutches. For example, semicolon insertion. JavaScript, because it's running over there, its job is to, well, keep going. So if it finds a syntax error, it's going to back up and see if it can insert a semicolon and make the code continue. Is that what the developer intended? I don't know. That's the methodology, is that JavaScript should be able to continue running wherever possible. Because, well, what we're shipping is not a compiled experience. What we're shipping is our JavaScript source code. Now, we may use Webpack or Babel to transpile JavaScript into different JavaScript, but at the end of the day, we are shipping JavaScript to the browser. So JavaScript is weird. It is quite weird. Let me see if I can get this Zoom window. Nope, I can't. JavaScript is weird. And when we start digging into the weird parts, it gets particularly weird. Like, why are we able to define undefined? That's weird. In more recent versions of JavaScript, undefined is a constant that you can't override. But yeah, when it was created, undefined was a variable. And you could change it. Here's another weird one. Type of null. Type of null is an object. Okay. I kind of get it. You know, it is object-like, but it so probably fits in the object category more so than anything else. Here's one that's particularly weird. Type of not a number. Now, not a number is kind of in the number category, so I can see why type of nan is number, but I kind of want type of nan to be object or undefined or, you know, something else. The fact that I can say, is this a number? And it says yes, but its definition is not a number. That's weird. The compiler. The compiler in JavaScript is a two-pass compiler. When we look at this mechanism, the first pass is a compilation phase. It goes and looks for all of the variable declarations, and it sets aside the memory that it needs to be able to fulfill those requests. The second pass, the execution phase, is where it actually runs the code. Now, this two-pass compiler is a really interesting mechanism. Now, granted, modern JavaScript compilers do a whole lot more about just-in-time compilation or optimizing query trees or doing all kinds of tree shaking. That mechanism is definitely part of the JavaScript runtime and the JavaScript engine. But at its core, the JavaScript compiler is still these two phases. Go find all the variables and declare them, and then go execute all the code. So as we look at this JavaScript two-phase compiler, and we look at this code, we see some interesting things. Here inside on line 7, we are declaring a variable. So the first thing the JavaScript compiler is going to do is it's going to look through the code. It's going to find this variable declaration. It's going to go, okay, I've got a variable defined. Second pass is it's going to go execute all the code. So we define this main function, and then we go execute the main function. We're going to dig in and we're going to log all the things. So as we look at this code and we look at it as the compiler here, we can see this variable is defined and then the function is executed. Well, how do we explain this to ourselves? Well, probably we've heard of variable hoisting. Now, variable hoisting is a lie. It's a lie that we tell ourselves so that we can kind of imagine this as a completely synchronous one-phase pass. And so if it only did one pass and the pass kind of looked like this, yeah, that would make sense to us. It's not that way, but variable hoisting is a mechanism that we can use to try and understand our code and to be able to reason about how this code works. So if we think like the compiler, what might this code do? Well, we define this function and then we call the function. First step in the function, we have this pretend hoisted variable, and it is not set yet. So its variable is its value is undefined. Then we console log. What's its value? Well, undefined. So we get undefined here. If true, let's set foo to bar. Now, what's interesting about JavaScript is that functions define scope, curly braces do not. So now this foo variable that we defined here is set to bar and will write out bar. If we think like the compiler, we have that mechanism that says, let's log undefined and then let's log bar. So that's interesting. Hoisting, it's a lie. It's a lie we tell ourselves to make sense of this two-pass compiler. Now, if we think like the compiler, some of the weird things in JavaScript can make a whole lot more sense. That's cool. Let's dig into a bunch. Today, we're going to dig into variable hoisting, defining and not defining variables in various places. We'll dig into this and how to control it. We'll dig into the event loop, and we'll dig into async and await, thinking like the compiler. So here's the first step, scope. Now with scope, we're going to define these two variables. We have one outside the function and one inside the function. Now, as we define variables, we know that these variables exist in the defined scope. JavaScript has a mechanism for identifying the variables and crawling up the scopes to be able to find them. So what do you think this code is going to do? Let's think like the compiler and see if we can figure it out. The first pass, we're going to go look for variable declarations. So we find this one, let's call that foo1. And we'll find this one, we'll call that foo2. We could also call this outer foo and inner foo. We've identified those two variables. Now they're not set yet, we've just set aside memory for those. Now phase two, let's run it. We start out by running this function. Or we start out by declaring it and setting its value to bar. So outer foo is set to bar. Now we're going to run this function. And as we declare this function, we find the second variable and we're going to set this one to baz. Outer foo is bar, inner foo is baz. If true, remember that curly braces don't declare scope, functions do. So now we're going to look for a foo variable. Is there a foo variable in our scope? Why, yes, we found inner foo, its value is baz. We're going to override that and set its value to bam. Let's console log foo, and its value right now is bam. We'll leave the curly braces and we'll console log foo and we'll log bam a second time. Now we've reached the end of our function. This function finishes, the scope completes, and those variables are no longer available. And if we had closures, they would be. But now we get down here and we console log foo. Where is the foo in this outer scope? Well, we have this foo one, this outer foo, and its value is bar. So here we got bam, bam, and bar. Is that what you got? This is really fun. Let's do another example and start to think like the compiler. We've changed the code like this. What will happen? Let's think like the compiler and figure it out. We're going to first look through the code looking for variable declarations. Let's do this first pass. We find outer foo here, and here's foo two. Okay. It fails code review. Yes. Now let's execute it. We start out calling our function, and we're going to try and find a foo variable in our current scope and wander up scopes to be able to find it. We do have this variable defined in our current scope. So that's the variable, and we will set it to Baz. We come in here, we set it to bam, and we log it. We've logged bam. Leaving this curly brace, we log bam a second time. Leaving this function, we now go looking for a new foo, and this foo is defined out here, and it's still set to bar. So we get bam, bam, and bar. Is that what you got? Let's do it again. Now we're defining our variables a little bit differently. What's going to happen in this code? Let's think like the compiler and all the same foo. Yes, they're all the same foo. Let's think like the compiler and figure it out. First pass, we define this one variable. That's the only one that we're declaring. Now we set it to bar, and then we execute this function. Here we're going to set it to Baz. Now this goes looking for a foo variable. It doesn't find any defined in the current scope. And so it reaches outside to the next scope. It will keep walking up the scopes until it gets to the global scope, not finding a variable there, it will define one. So here we walk up to a larger scope, we find this variable declared here, and so now we set its value to Baz. Foo is now Baz. Inside true, we're gonna go find that variable again, reach this variable again, we'll set it to bam, and so we will log bam, bam. Outside here, we're still logging that bam, and we get bam all the way through. We got a lot of foo soup. Let's define it a little bit differently. Let's go like this. Now, what's this code gonna do? Let's think like the compiler and see if we can figure it out. First pass, we're looking for variable declarations. In this case, we don't find any. So our first pass, we do nothing. Second, we're gonna go run our code. First line, we're gonna go look for a foo variable and we're gonna set its value to bar. Now we're up here in this top scope. We go looking for something defined. Nothing's defined. We're gonna keep walking up the scopes until we get to the global scope. We still didn't find any foo variable, so we're gonna define one in the global scope. We're implicitly defining global variables. So we set its value to bar. Now we're gonna execute this function. We're gonna go find the foo variable again. Well, there's nothing defined in this scope. There's nothing defined in this upper scope. We're gonna keep wandering until we find that global variable that was defined in this line. Let's set its value to Baz. We'll do the same thing here, setting it to bam, and walk all the way back out. We have three bams. And we have an implicit global variable. Is that what you meant? What if the variable name was I? Well, if I happen to not declare my variable and you happen to not declare your variable and we both called our variable I, then my loop would overwrite your loop. We're using the same variable. Is that what we intended? Screaming intensifies. Yes. Let's do this example. What happens in this case? Now let's think like the compiler and see if we can figure it out. I'm pretty sure that Michael's going to completely fail my code review now. So we've defined this variable out here. First pass, we're defining the variables and we find this on line one. Okay, second pass, we're going to assign that to bar. In all the places, we only have that one declaration. So we're going to set it to bar or to baz here. And now here we're setting it to bam. Now we know that mechanism of crawling up the scopes looking for variables. So we're going to crawl up the scopes. Is there a bam defined in here? No. Is there a bam defined in here? No. Is there a bam defined in the global scope? No. So we're going to throw a reference exception. Bam is not defined. Wait a minute. Last time when we went to go use a variable that didn't exist, we just magically got it created for us. Yes, we were setting the value of a variable that didn't exist. So JavaScript being helpful and saying, I'll make your code run, created one. In this case, we're trying to read the value of a variable that doesn't exist. Well, there isn't such a value, so we error. Okay, so yeah, now we need to declare all our variables, but this is interesting. We have a quirk here where writing to a variable that doesn't exist is different behavior than reading from a variable that doesn't exist. When we think like the compiler, this completely makes sense. That two-pass mechanism and that mechanism where JavaScript wants to forgive mistakes yields different results in this case. JavaScript is weird, but it makes sense when we think like the compiler. Let's take another example. What happens in this case? Mistakes were made. Yes. So I'm going to take it, and rather than defining them as var, I'm defining them as let. How does this change the execution of our code? Let's think like the compiler and figure it out. What's interesting about let and const that is different from var is let and const have curly brace scope. It works the way we expect it to work in all of our other C-style languages. Okay, so let's think like the compiler. First phase, let's go define this variable. First phase, let's go define this variable. We now have an inner foo and an outer foo. Now, second phase, let's run it. Foo equals bar, that's great. We call into our function. Now we're gonna go look for a foo here on line four. We don't have a variable defined in our scope in this foo because this one is defined in a separate curly brace scope. It is a let variable that is only defined inside this curly brace. So we go looking for an outer foo. Oh, we've got one here. So let's set outer foo to baz. If true, let's define inner foo, set it to bam, console log bam. Now we console log outside of our curly brace. What's the foo that we found outside of our curly brace? It's this one up here on line one. So we'll output its current value, baz. We've got bam, baz, and here outside, we also get baz. Is that what you got? Let's do it again. Let's comment out the outer foo. Now what happens? Our first step is to go define variables. We're going to go take a first pass and we'll find this variable declaration and we'll set that aside. Okay, now we're going to go call bar. Now, last time we did this, we had a foo variable and we set it in place so it defined it here. Here we don't. Okay, let's go find foo in the current scope. Do we find it? No, we don't. Let's reach up into the next scope. Do we find it out here? Nope, we don't. We'll keep reaching up scopes until we define a variable in the global scope because we have no other variables. Okay, foo now equals baz. This is a global variable, global foo, and its value is now baz. Here inside the curly braces, it's let, So we're defining a new variable scope to these curly braces, and we say bam, console log bam here, console log this variable that is a global foo, so that one's baz, and outside here, we go looking for a variable called foo. Well, we're in this scope, and there's nothing defined in this scope. We're going to keep wandering up scopes until we get to the global scope and find the variable that we defined here on line 4. And that value is baz. So bam, baz, baz. It's weird, but when we think like the compiler, it totally makes sense. Now, instead of let's change them to... Oh, now we're going to define it twice, once here and once here. What happens in this case? Let's think like the compiler and figure it out. First pass, we define this foo and this foo. Second pass, we're going to go execute it. We'll call into bar. This outer foo is baz. The inner foo is bam. We log the inner foo. That's value is bam. We log the outer foo, its value is baz. So we get bam and baz. And now we're out here and we're looking for a foo variable. This one was defined inside the function. This one was defined inside the curly brace. And both of those scopes have expired. Those variables are not accessible to us anymore. So we go looking for a different foo. Is there one defined in this scope? No. We keep climbing scopes until we get to the global scope. We find no global foo. And we get a reference error. We're trying to read the value of a variable that doesn't exist. And we get an exception. So how about this? Now we're defining them not as let, but as const. Const has curly brace scope in the same way that let does. And so now what do we get? Let's think like the compiler and figure it out. We start by declaring a const foo out here in our outer scope. We declare this const foo on our inner scope. That's the first pass. Second pass, we're going to declare the outer one as bar. Now this is a constant. If we're running in an environment that has ES6 support, these constants will be enforced by the JavaScript runtime engine. So we call bar and we go set foo equal to baz. Do we have a foo in this scope? We don't. Let's climb up the scope and we get to this foo. And now we're trying to change a constant variable. And yes, you're right, Michael. We get a type error, assignment to a constant variable. Well, what if we were running this code inside of Babel and compiling to a target of ES5? Well, const is an ES6 construct, not an ES5 construct. And so these consts will get turned into vars. And well, yeah, vars are not enforced as constants in environments. So it would function just fine. It would error for me locally because I'm running a higher version of Node. It would work just fine in the production website. Wow, that's weird. If we change our Babel compilation, not to target ES5, but to target ES6 or maybe even ES2020, then we get runtime behavior as we expect. That was cool, digging into all kinds of variable declarations and not declarations. In the end, yeah, the JavaScript runtime is weird, but when we think like the compiler, we can figure it out. Any questions so far on declaring or not declaring variables?
Rob, I have a question.
When would will Babel check for these mistakes by default? It will not. Babel will highlight undeclared variables. So in the case where we didn't declare it at all, Babel would note that. But console logging a variable that doesn't exist, it may not be able to catch that. It won't catch things where we're naming the variable the same inside and outside of the scope because, well, it doesn't have a rule for that. ESLint may be able to catch that if you turn on that ESLint rule, but there is a good reason to have maybe an outer I incrementer and an inner I incrementer. So a lot of people choose to turn that off by default. Great question. So let's dig into the next part. This. What is this? Is JavaScript having an existential crisis? No. This is the thing to the left of the dot. I think that definition is wonderful. If you want to dig into more about that, here's a read more and a watch more where you can look at what is this. If we learn JavaScript first by learning jQuery, jQuery was really good at overloading this, setting it to a value that made sense given the context that it was trying to use it in. But we're not in jQuery, we're just in regular JavaScript. And so this is the thing to the left of the dot. So here's some code that does exactly that. Let's console log this.name here on line 2. And let's play with this in various places. Now we have this speak function. We could have duplicated this speak function as we defined every object. We could have created a constructor function that defined it, but we have these two objects and they both have a speak method. Name equals ninja. So I have this declaration outside of any object and I'm going to call the speak method outside of any object. What happens here? The thing to the left of the dot is, well, the global scope, or the current scope rather, we're in the speak method. And so when we go log this.name, we're going to get this variable defined out here. If we say object1.speak is this method. And so while we're inside object one, we will get the doctor. Object2.speak will get Skywalker. So running this code, ninja, doctor, Skywalker. Yeah, that kind of makes sense. Line 9 is the one that trips us up a little bit because there's nothing really to the left of the dot. But here, to the left of the dot is object 1. It makes sense that we would have doctor. Object 2, that makes sense that we would have Skywalker. That's cool. Our to the left of the dot rule works out just fine. Let's do it again. Now, I'm going to grab a variable that equals the function object1.speak. Now, functions are first-class citizens inside of JavaScript, so we can pass them around as variables, we can pass them around as parameters, we can use them in functions to do interesting things. So what happens in this code? We start out by calling object1.speak. Now, the thing to the left of the dot is obj1, so inside this speak variable, we have this.name, here's obj1. One, and we output the doctor. Now we're going to define obj_speak. Now this method, as we call it, there is nothing to the left of the dot. It used to be inside this object, but we pulled it out. So when we go call this one, we get undefined. Why is it undefined and not a reference exception? Because name gets defined a lot by a lot of other things. So I took some liberties and assumed that it would be defined by now. How about this? Now we have a button that's going to help us a little bit. We'll do a document.getElementById. We'll go grab the button. Let's assume we've got some markup that defines a button that matches here. Now we have a button. Button.addEventListener. When the click event happens, we will call the speak method. What's the thing to the left of the dot in this case? The button. That's cool. So when I click this button, I come into the speak method, I output this.id. And in this case, I know this.id is the button. So we get the button. That's cool. What's the thing to the left of the dot? That rule works out really well. Now I'm going to do something interesting. Let's do a set timeout. I don't want to show quite yet. I want to wait for that function to, I want to create a new scope that defines this. So now what happens? Well, I call speak. Speak will go do the thing. It will create this new function and then console log this.name. What's the thing to the left of the dot in this? Well, it's this function. This function is executing in the global scope, so we get name, ninja. That's cool. Set timeout, the famous hack of JS developers everywhere. I agree. Now, how about object1.speak? Well, I'm calling speak here. And so what's the this right here on line one? Well, it's this object one, but I call set timeout and I give it a new scope. After 100 milliseconds, when this function spins up, what is the this? Well, it is this function, this global scope. And so we get object1.speak. They both say ninja. That's not what we wanted. What can we do about that? Let's take a look at changing this based on different mechanisms within JavaScript. Here's a method called call. With call, I can pass in the this that I want to do. Call will execute the method right away. So here in object two, we're not defining a speak method. What happens here? Well, object one goes and defines, calls it speak method. So when we get in here, this.name, this is object one. And so we get the doctor. That's perfect. As we call object1.speak.call, we're passing in what is the this in this case. And the this is object two. So we're going to run this method right now. That's what call does. We come into speak, and this is now object two. So we get doctor and Skywalker. That's cool. We were able to change this and call the function with the this of our choice. Now we could actually pass parameters here and they would show up as parameters inside this method. And so you might see call object two and then some other parameters to the method. That's totally fine too. You may also see it kind of like this. Oh, so let's come back to our button push example. Here in our button push example, we know that call will change this. So here in our function, we're gonna go use set timeout. We're gonna go push the button. What happens here? Oh, this one isn't the button, my bad. Okay, so we define object one and it has the speak method, but we're gonna call speak without anything. Our global name is ninja. And so set timeout, we're gonna call this. What is the this right now? Well, it is the global object. So when we execute this, we'll get this.name. But we're executing it right away. What are we passing to set timeout? We're passing the results of this function. And the results is undefined. So in 100 milliseconds, it will run undefined. But right now, it outputs ninja. How about when we call obj1? Okay, so we call speak. We do this function, we dot call it, and we get doctor. And then the results of this function are, we'll wait for 100 milliseconds. And so we get the right answers, but it didn't wait. We called dot call right away, and dot call run right away, just executed. Okay, we have another mechanism where we can do this, dot bind. We can think of dot bind, and this is a fake implementation, of saying, let's create a new function, this closure, that has a function.call in it. So maybe we pass in our function and we pass in what we want this to be, let's call it that. And then later when we call this new function that we're returning right here, then we will call that function that we passed in with the this that we wanted to. Okay, so this fake bind, we will get the this that we expect. Now that isn't actually the signature of bind. Here's the signature of bind where we take the method and we say dot bind and we pass in the this that we want it to do. Okay, so we're not defining a speak right here, but we're taking object one speak method, binding it to the object two, and now we have a new method that we can call. If we say object1.speak, we get the correct name, we get doctor. If we call obj2speak, what's the thing to the left of the dot? Well, we changed it when we did a dot bind here. We returned a new function with this already baked into place. So we call obj2speak, which was bound to obj2, and we get Skywalker. bind is a really good way to do an apply, but later. And it uses closures to make that happen. You may see a lot of code like this, where you say obj2.speak.bind obj2. Why do we have that? React is really good at needing functions like this to be able to bind its classes back to its methods. Well, because we really, really, really want to set what this means inside of our functions, we don't want a button click to change what this means to a global scope or a set timeout or whatever. So we'll have obj2.method.bind obj2. That's why. So let's take this back to our set timeout example. And we want to do .bind to be able to change this. Okay, we have our obj1, we call speak. Now here, this will bind this, returning a new function that gets called in 100 milliseconds. Okay, so we speak, we wait 100 milliseconds, then we call this.name. We know that it was bound, and so what was the this when it was first called? Well, it's this global name here, ninja. On line 10, we get ninja after 100 milliseconds. How about this one, obj1.speak? We come in here, what is the this that we're binding into place? It is obj1. And then when we go to execute this, we've already bound this, and so we will get doctor. I think we've solved our set timeout problem with bind. That worked out really well. Let's change this with arrow functions. Now, the cool thing about arrow functions is it automatically binds this at the point where this function is defined. Now, that's a wonderful and awkward, helpful thing, but in this case, it's much like .bind this. We can kind of think of those as parallels. An arrow function will automatically bind to this as it is declared. Now, if you want that functionality, arrow functions are amazing. But if your goal is just to reduce the number of characters from function, this really long word, to less characters, then you will have some side effects. You are binding this at the point where you declare the function. If you declare the function and this is not what you expect, then this will happen to you too. Okay, so let's take this for a spin. We have an arrow function here that defines this the way we expect. Now we've got this speak variable. Let's bind that into object 1 and object 2. And now we call speak and it will output its this. Well, the this that was created when this function was declared is this name here. Let's pretend it was hoisted. We know that's not the case, but that's the name that we found. So we call speak and we get ninja. Perfect. We call obj1speak. Well, to the left of the dot is obj1. So we would expect this to be doctor, right? But we bound it when we created it. And when we bound it, name was the thing that was bound. So obj1speak is ninja. Obj2speak is also ninja. That side effect of automatically binding to this bit us in this case. Now, if we had defined the function right in line here, we would have had the correct answer because now this would have been the object that we were building. But we defined it out here and then copied it into place. And so this was already bound. Hey, I know a trick. We have a dot bind. Let's dot bind our arrow function, obj2.speak.bind obj2. That'll fix it, right? Well, this got bound here as we defined the function. What is the this that got bound? It's this name here. Now we do dot bind and we're binding to obj2. So we have this function bound to obj2 that calls this function bound to the outer scope. We have already bound this, so calling bind again won't change what this was when it was created. Wrapping it in another this won't alter its behavior. And in spite of all of our best efforts, we got ninja all the way through. Arrow functions have some side effects. if you have the rule that just says remove all function statements and replace them with arrow functions, that may not be what you're opting into. What you're opting into is binding this when you declare the function. If you've used Mocha and you want to change the timeout, but you've arrow functioned all the things and suddenly your timeout isn't working, yeah, that's exactly what's happening. Mocha injects a this into all the places. And because you're using past functions, as it goes and grabs the variable, it will keep walking up the chain until it finds the this that Mocha defined. If you create an arrow function, it captures the this when your test was created, and that this is blank. You now say this dot test timeout, and Mocha's like, yeah, I never saw it. Okay, so back to our set timeout example. Can we use arrow functions to be able to help us here? Now we did do our dot bind and that worked. Let's try this one. As we do this, we'll define our object, we'll set speak into place. Our first speak here, inside here, our this is currently the outer scope. We set timeout. We create this arrow function that binds that scope into place. So we have this outer function. In 100 milliseconds, we grab this.name and it is ninja. Perfect. Here, when we call obj1.speak, obj1 is the thing to the left of the dot. So right here on line one, obj1 is the this. We're going to create this arrow function in place with obj1 in scope. And so this is obj1 and we get doctor. That works in spite of the set timeout because, well, this is bound correctly as we created this right here. Now, if we were to create this outer function as an arrow function, it wouldn't function correctly. But we're leveraging this mechanism where it grabs the scope, the this, and binds it straight away. That's really elegant. The outer one is just a function. The inner one is an arrow function that will capture the current scope. That's cool. Knowing the difference between a function and an arrow function, we can leverage that difference for our benefit. Now, in this case, that wasn't obvious. We'll probably need to add a comment saying, I'm capturing the scope and I'm not capturing the scope so that future developers don't go, oh, let me arrow function all the things and I'll arrow function this and now it won't work. This. We're able to grab this. We're able to alter its behavior with apply, bind, and arrow functions. And we're able to take control of that to do really interesting things. Any questions so far on this? Let's dig into the event loop. The event loop. I love this event loop. Here's our function that we're going to execute. We're going to set timeout and we're going to have this counting function that will execute in 100 milliseconds. Then we'll loop through this, setting timeout again with this show function, and that will wait a second. Now, this is one of those great questions in JavaScript. What will I be? What I love about this site is it helps us to visualize that. Let me see if I can move this out of the way and go grab the code here. I love this site. Blatant video about how this site works, but here's our code. And we've got some interesting stuff to be able to hit there. Now, if we say save and run, it will start to execute our code. Now, this is the code that they added, and it's really fun to be able to see the call stack, web APIs that are waiting on completion, and the callback queue. The call stack is things that we're doing right now, and we'll empty the call stack. Once we've emptied the call stack, we'll go looking for things in the callback queue, and we'll pull them into the stack and execute them. These web APIs, these are things waiting in the wind that we'll just wait for them to execute. So we have this on button that will just get set waiting for a click to happen. Once this click happens, okay, that click function got pushed into the callback queue, nothing was in the callback queue, and we pulled it off the stack. Now we had that set timeout that got set in the waiting thing. Once it finished waiting, it got pulled into the callback queue as well. So let's go grab our code and take a look at this code in this test tool and visualize how it works. I'm going to save and run. And we start out, okay, so we put our counting thing in the callback queue. It finished, and now we pulled it out. Now we're looping through, sticking stuff into this callback queue. Now, once the show method expires, we'll stick our results here in the callback queue, but we're still counting. So because we're still counting, this callback queue continues to fill up. Once we finish executing our 10 items, it looks like we're on 8, 9, 10, there we go. Now we'll start to pop things off the callback queue and execute them. So what is it outputting? The current count is I, and the current count is I. And what is I right now? I is 10. I is 10, so we're console logging 10, 10, 10, 10. I love this mechanism of being able to visualize it. When we say set timeout, it sticks it out here. Then once it's done waiting for either user input or IO or whatever it needs to, we pull it into the callback queue. And then once the call stack is empty, we'll grab the next piece out of the callback queue and execute all of the things in the call stack. Let's go grab our last show and we've got it. Cool. I love this visualizer. As you grab the slides from robrich.org, make sure to hit this link and take a look at how that visualizer works. It is really cool. So up next, the event loop. We saw that mechanism where we have a stack and the GUI thread is processing this stack. Once the stack is empty, it will go look for content in the callback queue and push it into the stack. As things happen, closures, events, user button pushes, APIs that finish, then those will get stuck in the callback queue. And then as that becomes empty, then we'll pull those into the stack. This is the JavaScript event loop. How does this change in Node? Well, in Node, we are asynchronous to a fault. I love it. As we're digging through each of the things, we have a bunch of requests queued up. Now, this isn't actually how it works, but this is a good way to visualize it. Here's each of the requests. And we have the Node GUI process that goes to this request, and it drains its callback stack, or its stack. It will then look at content in the queue and run through that. Then it moves on to this one, draining its call stack, draining its stack, draining its stack. So, well, what if this request right here is looping from 1 to 1 million? Well, it never yields the thread. So all of these requests are sitting there waiting. JavaScript is single-threaded. And that's how you can bury a server, is doing computation on this thread rather than doing that asynchronously somewhere else. If you're in the middle of doing a computation and it's going to take a while, yield the thread so that the node process can go do a loop again and come back to you and calculate a little bit more. Now, all of these threads, all of these requests are responsive and you can calculate a little bit more. Yield the thread in the middle of each iteration of the loop if you have a tight loop that runs for a certain amount of time. And that way your node process will be a whole lot more responsive. Any questions on the JavaScript event loop or the node event loop? The comment is fantastic. I love it. So here's that node event loop. Set timeout. Set timeout is a good way to say, I yield control of the thread, come back to me in 0 seconds, 0 milliseconds. Well, it isn't actually 0 milliseconds. Rather, it's next time the node process loops around back to me. That's perfect. I'm basically just saying, I got dibs next time you come back to me, but I'm going to let each other request have a minute. If we're in async and await, we can say await process.nextTick. And the cool part in some modern versions of process.nextTick, You don't even have to pass in this empty function. You can just say await, it will return a promise. And when that promise resolves, then you'll continue on and you keep your current scope, which is wonderful. Whether you use set timeout and maybe bind or apply, or whether you use await process.next tick, this is good JavaScript hygiene to be able to let the rest of the requests in your Node app take a spin at the content in the application. If you're in a React app or an Angular app or a Vue app, and you notice that pushing the button locks up the UI for a time, add some await process.next tick in certain places, and your UI will suddenly be responsive again. Not that it isn't doing any less work, it's still doing that same amount of work. It's just yielding that single threaded JavaScript process a lot. That's really cool. If you can move to service workers where you can do the computation outside of your current process, then that's really cool. Now, service workers and web workers are a little bit different. And so I think I may have just used the wrong term. One of them facilitates caching, and that's really excellent. The other one is the way to do multi-threaded mechanisms inside of JavaScript. Basically, you spin up a new thread and you give that thread a task to do. Now, you can only pass messages between your service and your regular process. So it is kind of a high-end way to do this. But some JavaScript frameworks actually say, we're going to do all of our computation in a service worker and just let our UI thread marshal the messages back and forth to be able to do it. That's a good way to get off the GUI thread in a JavaScript application. So async and await. We've done declaring variables. We've talked about this and ways to control this. We've talked about the event loop. All of these things are weird, but as we get how JavaScript works, they make a whole lot of sense to us. And so we're no longer bound by the weirdness that is JavaScript. When we think like the compiler, it's a lot less weird. At face value, it still seems strange, but we know why it works. That's really cool. Let's dig into another one and figure out about async and await and promises. Now, async and await is really cool. If you've ever worked in C#, async and await in JavaScript was clearly inspired by C# implementation. In C#, we have the task parallel library, and async and await creates a state machine inside the task parallel library. In JavaScript, async and await creates a state machine with promises and generators. And that allows it to pick up at the next stage and continue on with its current scope. That's really cool. The syntax between C# and JavaScript is identical. So if you're familiar with C# async and await, then you'll be right at home. Under the hood, it is promises and generators. And we can leverage that fact because a promise awaited is the exact same thing. Let's take a look at this. Here's a promise library. So we have this call lib1, and it's going to return a new promise. As it returns a new promise, we give it a resolve and a reject arguments into our function. We're passing this function here into the promise mechanism. So here's our function. It's an arrow function capturing this. That's great. And we're going to call resolve after we finish doing our long running process. Now this returns a promise, and we're used to doing a promise dot then we can call the next library dot then we can dot catch at the end and grab any errors that happened in any of these libraries. We're familiar with promises and how they work. As we leverage async and await, we might have something like this. Here's async, and we're calling our long running thing, and then we return results. Well, we can await call lib1, and now we have this value. Await lib2, and we have this value. That's really cool. We get how promises work. We get how async and await works. Can we use them together, or do we have to wait until we upgrade our entire application to be able to use async and await? You know, get rid of all of the new promise things and return and change them into async functions? Well, recall that async and await is based on promises and generators. So let's do this. Here's an asynchronous function. Now we await some long-running task, and what we're returning here in this async function is a promise. Res is a promise. Now we're not awaiting this right here. We're actually just calling it straight out. But what we get out of this is a promise. That's really cool. We know how to dot then a promise to get a result. And so here, our promise-based code called our async and await code. I wrote a new library using async, and I called it using that old promises stuff. I didn't need to upgrade this other method too. I just called into my new code. That is cool. Marshalling between async and await and promises is really easy because what comes back from an async function is a promise that I can dot then to resolve. Let's take it the other direction. Here I have some legacy code that I want to call for my new code. This legacy code creates a new promise. I have a long running task and then it resolves or rejects. Here in my async function, I say, well, I want to call that function. Well, res is a promise. I can await a promise. Okay, so when I await the promise, I either get the result or I get an exception if reject was called. And so now I didn't need to wait for my application to get upgraded. I can put my new code calling into my old code. And I just await those promise-based results. I can get rid of that big dot then chain if I wanted to, just by awaiting each thing in turn. Promises and async and await. Async functions return a promise and I can await them. Async and await. Interop with promises is built in because the async and await creates a state machine based inside promises. So I can await a promise and I can dot then an async method. That's really cool. So how do I await many things in parallel? Well, here I have this collib1 and collib2, collib3. Here's my collib. It's an async function. And so it's going to return a promise. Now I'm not awaiting it here. I'm just harvesting those three promises. So now how do I do them in parallel? Well, we have a promise.all method, and given an array of promises, it will await, it will create a new promise that I can then, well, await. And the result of that is the array of results. I spin them all up, I don't await them. And then I promise.all until I get all their results. That's really cool. I was able to use that mechanism of async and await together with promises to be able to run all three of these things in parallel. Now, JavaScript is single-threaded, so they aren't actually running in parallel, but they're starting, and then the node event loop will loop through, and then each one will move a little bit farther and move a little bit farther until all three of these asynchronous tasks are complete. And at that point, then my code will continue on and I've got all three results. I can await many things in parallel. That's really cool. In C Sharp, an async method returns a task, and in JavaScript, it's a promise. Exactly. So JavaScript, not bad for a 10-day project 25 years ago. All else being equal, I think Brendan Eich did a wonderful job here with JavaScript. It is weird, it has some warts, but we got to see how thinking like the compiler and understanding what it's doing under the hood makes it a really reasonable result. If you're watching this video later, hit me up on Twitter at rob_rich and grab these slides right now at robrich.org. For those here in the meeting, what are your questions?
Hey, Rob, I have a quick question.
Definitely.
That was fantastic, and I'm very new, so forgive me if I'm that was fantastic. But what about nulls and handling like multiple libraries and awaiting that and the error handling within those? Does that have a play? Because there's some quirkiness with nulls and in between fetching that. And is it, what's your opinion of that?
Inside of promises and async and await, or what's the context where we bump into nulls?
Well, if you have an array of, let's say you have a null and you're looking for that had some sort of a computation on something that was counting on a numeric value on every index of each array, and you had a null within one of them, or there's and it didn't know what to do and throw an error. Would it throw an error on every one of those, or just compile only that array on the first index of that?
Good question. So if we hit an exception when we're in the middle of processing this, what happens? Here, we're not awaiting them. We're just grabbing their results. And then we're saying promise.all, and promise.all will wait for all of the results to finish, or it will throw on the first exception. So if, for example, collib2 hit a null when it was trying to index into this array, then collib2 would throw an exception. Let's pretend that one finished first, two then hit the exception, and three isn't done yet. So what results do I have right here? I don't have any results right here. I threw an exception and I landed into this catch error handler mechanism.
So it would definitely throw an error on the entirety of it. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Even if I was doing something like, I don't think I have that slide here. Even if I was doing something like awaiting all of these three, the moment that I hit that exception, I would throw and I would land here in my catch handler.
I appreciate that.
Yeah. To that end, if you're doing a loop like that, you might put a try catch in the middle of your loop so that you can catch that one thing that's failing and maybe take corrective action. Now, if you don't have anything that can recover from that and you hit the null and you just blow up, it's probably better to let that exception bubble all the way up and blow up your app. Because if you can't remedy it, you really want it to land in your global error handler where you can log that and note that that failure occurred. Many try catch swallows and you may not be able to find the source of your error. Like right here, I have this calling handle error. I don't just, have it doing nothing because, well, if it did nothing, I wouldn't even know that it erred. I'd presume that these three results were as I expected and I would end up with an empty object. And I'm like, that isn't what I expected.
Right. From a validation standpoint, would it be best to approach it from a validation standpoint then, or?
Yeah, definitely. If you've made the assumption that your entire array is numbers and no nulls, then that's probably a thing you want to validate early on.
I appreciate that.
That's where I like upgrading from JavaScript to TypeScript. Pardon me. Because TypeScript can start to do static analysis on your code and it won't tell you exactly when it hits a null at runtime. TypeScript is only a design time helper, but it can start to say, hey, I think this library that you just called might return null. And so you might want to take a look at handling the null right here rather than letting that potential null bubble all the way through your application. Great question. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
What other questions do we have right here?
Did you come up with all of this? I have to ask.
I was actually watching John Mills talk, and I'll plug him again because he's amazing. And he did a similar thing where he started talking about variables defined and not defined. And this part where I say, we'll probably hit the edge of my knowledge. I was that guy in the audience going, hey, what if you don't define it at all? And he's like, I don't know. And I talked to him afterwards. I'm like, I want to build a talk around this and talk about defining and not defining it. And he went, go for it. That's awesome. So that turned into, well, what do I do about this? And it was really cool. He touches on both defining and not defining and this in his talk, but then going through the event loop and async and await together with promises. That was all me.
Do you have any recommendations for like rubrics for kind of getting around these scoping potential errors?
A good rule of thumb is to always ensure that your inner scope and outer scope variables have different names. One of the things that bit us a lot, and let's get into one of those code examples, is that both the inner function and the outer function had the same name. And so turn on that ESLint rule that says you can't do that, and that'll help you find it, together with the ESLint rule that tries to find undefined functions. And it will say, hey, you need a const here instead of just saying foo. That's a really, really good way to start to find these. ESLint is a separate process, but either in VS Code or in your IDE of choice, you can probably integrate ESLint linting, checking, so that you get red squiggles under the code where it misbehaves. Falls, fails, add it as one of the tasks in your build step. And so then you can do an ESLint check before you build all the things and capture any syntax errors or likely things. You can turn up ESLint to ludicrous mode where it will tell you, you need a space right here and you need to not have a space. Don't turn it up that high, but you can definitely reference the plugins that are really helpful in being able to find those places where JavaScript can be dangerous because it behaves in very predictable but unexpected ways.
If nobody else has any other questions, I had a question just to learn more about it. Is yielding this multi-thread with the service worker and passing